Hello, friend. Welcome to another episode of Songwriter Analysis. So if you've been a Songwriter Theory listener, yes, this is a new show that we're adding to the repertoire. The other one is mostly diving into songwriting concepts from a generic standpoint. And then this is diving into specific songs and pulling from them different lessons that we can learn from the songs, different things they're doing. So it's sort of like the practical application. If you want to compare it to school, which I don't know why you would want to do that, but if you do, basically think of it like the lectures or class time is the podcast every Monday, which also video podcast. So be sure to subscribe if you want to learn about songwriting, because now we're going to have probably two videos a week. I'm not going to commit to two yet, but definitely every Monday. And hopefully this will also become every Thursday as well. And this is sort of like lab, right? So sometimes you have a lab for a science class to sort of really help make your knowledge practical and put it to use. So that's what this is sort of meant to fill the role of today. We were talking about Lewis Capaldi's Before You Go. I do want to dive right in, but if any of this music theory confuses you, be sure to go grab my free guide on the four pillars of music theory that every single songwriter needs to know. We're going to be using a lot of that stuff today. Be sure to grab that guide. Even if this doesn't confuse you, that's a great reference guide for the four pillars, just four things that you need to know about music theory to crush it at songwriting, to make songwriting so much easier, to make it faster, to be able to write more music, to be able to make more educated choices in the music you write, whether it be melodies or chord progressions or what, so you're not just stuck doing a 1-5-6-4 chord progression all the time and you could choose more meaningful chords. It'll be really helpful to you. Be sure to grab that free in the link in the description below. Let's dive right into the song.
I fell by the wayside like everyone else. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, but I was just kidding myself. Our every moment I started a place, cause now that the corner lie here were the words that I needed to say when you heard.
So that was the first verse. First thing, let's look at those lyrics a little bit. I fell by the wayside like everyone else. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, but I was just kidding myself. Our every moment I start to replace, because now that they're gone, all I hear are the words that I need to say. So in case you don't know the context of this song, it's at least inspired by his aunt when he was younger, committed suicide. So this is sort of from the standpoint of someone who has had a loved one recently commit suicide. So I fell by the wayside like everyone else. So person singing the song sort of stopped visiting the person, stopped talking to the person. They sort of just fell by the wayside, right? Like they're and also it's giving us context too that it's not like this is the only person who has like everyone else, right? So the information we have is pretty much everybody has a sort of abandoned this person. And then I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, but I was just kidding myself. General rule for all kinds of writing, repetition is to make a point, right? Sometimes repetition is lazy writing. Yes, absolutely. But a lot of times it's to make a point. And in this case, I think it's sort of twofold. One thing is it sort of changes up the rhythm a little bit to keep it rhythmically interesting. But also to sort of make a point of, I hate you, I hate you, I hate you. Almost like you're trying to convince yourself, right? Because I was just kidding myself, right? So there's sort of this aspect of, you know, I hate you, I hate you, I hate you. Like you're trying to convince yourself, right? Like if there's that girl or guy that you're interested in, you're like, no, I don't like them. I don't like them, right? It's sort of that kind of thing. But it's doing it in song, which in my mind, at least, is pretty effective. Our every moment I start to replace, because now that they're gone, all I hear are the words I needed to say. We've all done this, right? Where like you think of a moment in retrospect and you think now of the words that you should have said, but it's too late now. You can't do that, right? Sometimes it's that comeback, right? Somebody really gets you and you're like, and then an hour later you think of that great comeback and you're like, oh, why didn't I think of that then, right? Sort of same idea, except in this case, you know, it's, you know, the context is somebody has now committed suicide. Maybe you didn't know that they were struggling with depression. I don't know exactly what the story is there. At least we don't know yet. But there's that sense of regret, right, of the things you didn't say. And that's where this is going. So musically, it's got a nice little sus four in here. So this chord progression is one. So this is in the key of E flat. So one chord in the key of E flat. This is where if one chord doesn't make sense to you, be sure to go download that free guide. It will make all of this make sense. But one chord, then you have the sixth chord, which is a minor chord. So C minor. Then you have the four, and then you have the five. So not an uncommon chord progression. Don't think there's anything wrong with that. It is not the 1-4-6-5, of course. But it is similar. So 1-6-4-5. And then the five is that sus four, which is really what gives you that coming down feeling, because that B sus is suspended, but then it turns over here into just a regular B flat. So listen to that.
By the wayside, like everyone else. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, but I
see how it almost sounds
myself,
like trying to convince myself. I also changes up the rhythm.
I start a replace, because now that the corner lock, here were the words that I needed to say. When
you hear that little suspension in there? Arrangement wise, notice for this pre-chorus, there's one little synth guitar-like sound that was added, very subtle, but it helps set the tone of like we're progressing in the song. So let's go to that again. So this is the verse.
Cause now that the corner lock, here were the words that I needed to say.
Pre-chorus.
When you heard under the
melody changed.
Like troubled water.
Chord progression's the same though.
Cold.
Exactly the same.
Well, time can heal, but this won't. So
so that's a very common thing to do, right? To sort of have that song title tucked in there multiple times, and for that to sort of be that final line as well, the main point that you're trying to make. So that chorus does more or less fit into that 1-5-6-4, which I don't think is a problem. It can be a problem. It is the most used chord progression, but it can be done well. Something to notice is he actually changes up the way he plays his guitar arrangement wise. I believe it's starting after the pre-chorus. Yeah, so he's playing same chords, but see, because now you can hear some higher notes from that acoustic guitar. So part of it is the change in arrangement, right? Drums come in, you have bass come in, you have more sort of hard to distinguish synth-like drone sounds, if you will, that sort of just fill in the mix to help the chorus sound bigger. So it is 1-5-6-4, and then back to 5, and then 1-5-6-4, back to, this time it's 1-5-6-4-5, and then back to the 1 E-flat to go into the second verse. So chord progression wise, that's not super uncommon. Yes, we have that covered, but most people don't even notice chord progression. Chord progression doesn't really matter outside of, and I've talked to this about this before, if you're a listener to the Songwriter Theory show / podcast, but chords should supplement the melody. And really they're very important. And I think that chords are that X factor that can take your song to the next level, but really they're just to sort of give context to the notes that you're singing. because, you know, often people will say something like, well, C major is a happy chord. Like, well, C major is a happy chord in certain contexts. Yes. And then happy is very generic, right? Like, well, what does that mean? It depends what the melody is doing on the top of it, right? Like if you're belting a C with a C major chord, that's going to have a very different sound than you belting an A over a C major chord. Or your C major chord in the context of the key of C major is going to sound very strong and home because it's the one chord. But it's going to sound a little different in the key of G major, where it would be the four chord, because G, A, B, C, and C is not sharp in the key of G. So that's why it stays C, and it's not like C sharp or anything. And then in the key of like C sharp major, a C major chord would sound awful. It would not sound happy. So in a similar way, context is the main thing that matters. So really what's important is how it supplements the melody. And in this case, it certainly doesn't get in the way of the melody. I don't know how much it helps the melody, but it complements it pretty well. Lyrically, before you go, is there something I could have said to make your heart beat better? If only I had known you had a storm to weather. So before you go, was there something I could have said to make it all stop hurting? It kills me how your mind can make you feel so worthless. So this is sort of getting into the heart of the matter, right? I interpret the before you go because in this case, right, the person's already committed suicide, right? That's how this person knows and that all of these things that the person was dealing with. And we know that it's sort of in this case where the person's already gone because it's, was there something I coulda, well, it says coulda, but could have, right? Past tense said to make it all stop hurting, right? It's not, is there something I can say to make it all stop hurting, right? It's something I could have said to make it all stop hurting. So at least the way I imagine this is it's sort of like if somebody's spirit was visiting you, right? Before they left, or if you're imagining, right? So sort of the context that was set in that first verse of every moment I start to replace, because now that they're gone, all I hear are the words that I need to say, right? So sort of this, in your imagination, the things that you could go back and ask this person who's now gone. So before you go, right? Like it's almost like you're going back in time or talking to somebody's ghost before they vanish into the ether, if you will. Was there something I could have said to make your heart be better? So this whole chorus, right, is built around, was there something I could have done? Because I'm regretting all the words that I didn't say, which we covered in that first verse. And now this is sort of getting to the heart of it. Like, would it have made a difference, right? We've already covered that, you know, I fell by the wayside. I was kidding myself about hating you. And, are every moment I start to replace, because now I hear the words that I should have said. But now you're asking, okay, but would it have made a difference, right? Because at the end of the day, that's where the key to the regret is, right? Because sure, you might feel better about yourself if you said the right things before somebody passed. But in this case, there's almost this burden of partial responsibility, right? Like, oh man, was there something I could, like a life might be gone partially because of things I did not do. And to me, this does a really good job, even melodically, of conveying the idea that this person is desperate to know, could I have changed anything? Because it's sort of weighing on their conscience. We'll dive into it maybe a little bit more for the second chorus, but let's move to the verse. Second verse. If I can re-find it.
So, there you go. Before you go,
was never the right time. Notice that driving kick drum to help the second verse sort of accelerate, if you will.
Or every moment I start to replay. But all I can think about is seeing that look on your face. When you
back to the pre-chorus. Notice this background vocal system.
Like troubled water running cold. What some can heal but this won't.
Couple things on that. So first verse musically is the same. But never the right time whenever you called, right? So didn't pick up your phone call because it just wasn't the right time, right? I never made the time to pick up your phone call. Little by little by little. So as again, that rhythmic change up. And again, repetition usually to make a point. And again, sort of like how it was used the first time, right? The I hate you, I hate you, I hate you to try to convince yourself kind of thing. In the same way that you would do if you were in high school trying to convince yourself you don't like that person you have a crush on, or I don't know, maybe you still do that as an adult. Which if so, maybe stop. Just saying. So for your own good, for your own good. I'm not being judgy, just for your own good. So, excuse me. So little by little by little until there's nothing else. So that sort of conveys, like, you can almost picture the, like, almost that slippery slope concept, right? If you take a shovel and just do one dig, right? That makes a tiny little hole, right? But if you keep doing that tiny little, you're digging a hole. Soon you have a hole, giant, massive hole, right? So it's by the repeating of that thing over and over and over, right? It's like how one can make compromises little by little by little until you find yourself totally trapped, right? Say alcohol, right? Yeah, maybe you start with like, I'm not gonna drink any alcohol. Then you're like, well, one beer a day is fine. That's fine. Two beers a day, that's fine. Three beers, right? It's usually people, when they find themselves in a rough spot, it was little compromises along the way instead of a hard line, right? So, and I'm not coming down on alcohol, just to be clear. I'm just saying, like, an example of, like, usually an alcoholic doesn't just, like, decide overnight. Like, they don't go from, like, I don't drink to, like, I'm going to drink 30 beers a night, which obviously hyperbole, but usually it's a little by little, right? It's this, you just keep making little compromises until you find yourself where you don't want to be. So little by little by little until there's nothing at all, right? So at first, you know, maybe I didn't make time for your phone call 3 weeks out of the 4 weeks that you called. Then I missed 3 out of the 4 months that you called. Then it was, I only had time for your phone call once every 2 years, right? Like, so that little compromise by little compromise until, you know, it was really significant. Or every moment I start to replay, but when all I can think about is seeing that look on your face. So again, this is setting up that pre-chorus, which then that pre-chorus, the change in melody, right? So we talked about pre-choruses the other week on Songwriter Theory and how to write them. So this is a pretty good example of a pre-chorus. When it feels like the ante is raised every time from the verse kind of settles around, you know, say like a 5 in energy. It's pretty calm. And then that pre-chorus sort of adds that little bit, like, oh, we're stepping up to the chorus. So sort of this idea of, you know, you can either jump from the verse to like a big chorus, or you can take the stairs, right? But you're just upping the energy slowly. So it has this almost inevitable pull, right? Because after somebody takes 4 steps, you're like, oh, I know where this is going. They're going to keep stepping until they get to the top of the stairway. Whereas when somebody jumps, you know, outside of humans are pretty limited in jumping, like, you don't know, where are they going to land, right? Are they going to land 7 feet away because they're some long jump expert? Or are they going to, you know, are they just doing a little hop because they're dancing? I don't know, making up stuff. But you get what I'm saying, hopefully. And if you don't, dislike this video, just kidding. But if you're getting value from this, be sure to drop a like. So let's listen to that again. I think I pointed out while it was happening, but let's listen again to the end of this verse and how it changes in that chorus or pre-chorus. So notice the pre-chorus at first, for when you heard under the surface, like troubled water running cold. For that part, there's a choir in there. But then when it gets to the, well, time can heal, but this won't, it actually, the choir goes away and it gets smaller. And I think there's 2 reasons for this. One is, I think the when you heard under the surface, like troubled water running cold, that's a big concept that anyone can relate to. So it's sort of this like inclusive, like you know, you in concert would be like, you know, candle back and forth. And you're like, yes, when I heard Under the Surface, like troubled water running cold, right? We all can relate to that on some level, I'm sure. Even if you're an abrasively happy person. Yes, I said that on purpose, abrasively happy. There's some of you out there that are just too happy all the time. Too much. But hey, good for you. You're probably not here though, because songwriters usually, I think we tend to be more the other way. So, excuse me. So this is sort of more a general concept that anybody can relate to. But well, time can heal, but this won't. Yes, we can all relate to that. But I think he wanted to pull that in to be a little more intimate, right? To really give that extra punch, right? Because there's sort of a bigness to like, let's all hold hands and relate to one another over this thing, which some songs sound like, right? And the beginning of this pre-chorus sort of sounds like to me anyway. Don't worry, we're going to listen to it again. I'm just giving you this preface so that you can listen to this with the context of what I'm saying, so you can determine for yourself why you think it was done this way. So I think this is, so it's pulling us back to be more intimate so that it hits a little harder when the chorus comes. And then that's the other point. I talked a lot about like, you know, how big a chorus feels, how epic something feels is all based on the context before it. So I think the other part of this is they wanted the growth at the beginning of the pre-chorus, but bringing it back to being a little smaller and a little more intimate for the, well, time can heal, but this won't, almost so that it turns really soft by the end of that. It helps that so before you go of the next chorus really hit hard. So listen for all that stuff here. Nothing at all, or every moment. So this is the end of the second verse. But all I can think about is seeing that look on your face when you heard under the surface like troubled water running cold. Some can heal, but this won't. Just his voice alone. So that helps that chorus hit harder, right? It sort of fades out at the end. Makes that chorus feel big. Notice, and we'll talk about this a little more, I think, for that final chorus, but the title comes naturally from this, right? Before You Go is the highlight of the melody, right? Especially the second time he hits the Before You Go in the chorus, I believe it's the highest note in the song. It really accentuates that, right? Like, Before You Go, like, that's the main thing that keeps trying to draw attention to. Those are the high notes, right? Even to the point that if you look at how these lines are written, especially over here, really makes a point of it. So, all by itself on a line, Before You Go, was there something I could have said to make your heart beat better? All on one line. And a part of that is a stylistic choice, but really, like, so is held for a while, and Before You Go really gets its own line, is really accentuated. And then, was there something I could have said to make your heart beat better, is a little bit more driving of a sound, right? So there's a contrast of, so Before You Go, reaching up, getting that high note, belting, was there something I could have said to make your heart beat better? And it's not that fast, obviously, but there's this sense of like, we are really highlighting the Before You Go. And then to fit more lyrics in, the melodic speed, if you will, of the other parts are faster, but also slowing down that speed and making a point with the high note with Before You Go really helps accentuate that part of the song, making it so that, you know, it's the obvious title for the song. So now we're going to go into the bridge, which, by the way, changes up the chord progression to something we haven't seen before in this song, because we have the one chord progression that's shared in the verses and pre-chorus, which is the 1-6-4, and then it goes 5, but suspended back to a regular 5. So if you don't know, again, go pick up that music theory guide. It will help you. But so B sus, B flat sus four versus B flat. That just means that the third of the chord is raised. So these chords are all triads, right? So a first, a third, and a fifth. For a sus four, you're actually raising that third to make it a fourth. So you have a one, a four, and a five. And then that the normal triad, so the B flat, that four is coming back down to a one. So you're sort of suspending that fourth and then coming down back to the third to make that triad, again, that regular major triad of the 1-3-5, which in the case of a B flat chord would be a B flat, a D, and an F. All right. So, bridge. Changes in chord progression. We're going 6-4-1-5-6. And then back to 4-5-5 still, and 1. So change up in chord progression. It's very common, like I said before, to even go to the minor, relative minor key in the bridge. In this case, it's not going to the relative minor key, it's staying the same key, but it is definitely making good use of that C minor. It's the first time that he's really opened a section not with the one chord, right? Every single chorus, verse, pre-chorus all opens with that one chord. This time he's opening with the sixth chord for the first time in the song, which really helps to accentuate, hey, this is a different section. This is the bridge. We're going off and doing something different now. Before you go, we'll be better off by now. If I let my walls come down, maybe I guess we'll never know. It's the earlier. So here sort of functions as a climax of the song that I guess we'll never know. The question that I keep asking in the chorus, I guess I'll never know the answer. Would we be better off by now? Would you still be alive now if I'd let my walls come down, right? If I showed myself to you and was my true self with you, ignore your phone calls, but was a friend to you, was a good nephew to you, I guess, which sounds weird, a good nephew to you. But anyway, you know, so if you were a better friend to your friend, if you were a better husband to your wife, if you were a better wife to your husband, etc., whatever your situation, you know, would this have not happened? Maybe, I guess we'll never know. You know. So there's a sense of, you know the answer to this question, but you're not here anymore. And I guess I will never know. Sort of relenting, right? Like the tragedy within this song, right, is the chorus. The main thing that you're asking in the chorus, you will never be able to get the answer to. And that's sort of the root tragedy in this song. The tragedy of suicide, of course, is the bigger tragedy. But the specific tragedy that is within this song, the context is the tragedy of suicide. The actual tragedy within the story of the song is right here in the bridge, right? It's where everything comes to a head and really comes to a thematic climax where we're establishing this main thing I want the answer to. Before you go, was there something I could have said? I'll never know the answer to that. And there's no solution. I just will never know the answer. This third chorus, let's just listen to it and we'll talk about what it's doing here. You know, before you go, was there something I could have said to make your heart beat better? If only I'd have known you were the storm to weather. So do you notice how desperate that sounds? That high note in "Before You Go," really, really, really good emotional melody. It really does a good job conveying the desperation in this song of please, please tell me, even though I know that you can't tell me. Was there something I could have said to make it all stop? So a couple of things I want you to notice before we really listen to that. First, the first half of that chorus, it's broken all the way down to just acoustic guitar and his voice. And so and it's also a different guitar part than the one that has been highlighted before. So if we go back to the first chorus for a second. Before you go, there's sort of this finger picking, or maybe it's pick picking. There, right? And then for the second chorus, there's actually two guitars starting there with that same finger picking pattern, or again, it might be pick picking. I'm not really sure. Doesn't really matter. It does matter for tone and sound, but in the context of what we're talking about, it does matter. And then in the second chorus, though, there's that guitar, and then there's another acoustic guitar, which helps make this song feel big and yet still acoustic, is because a lot of the instruments that are sort of working together here are either sort of ethereal and on the outside, bass and low, or they're some of the main instruments are guitars, adding a lot of texture and stuff to this, which is how it can sort of feel bigger and have an epic feel, also because of the melody. But still feel kind of acoustic singer-songwritery is a part of why that is. Before you go, so if you hear, there's also a strummed guitar. You can't really hear the notes as much because it's mixed in a way to, it's really to add texture. But you also have that picking pattern acoustic guitar that you've had since the beginning. And since that first chorus, but I think what's in the background, or that second acoustic guitar here, that strumming pattern is actually the one that is then featured for that last chorus at the beginning. I could have said to make it all stop, but it kills me how your mind can make you feel so awful. It's definitely farther back, and a little harder to hear. So if you're not wearing headphones, you probably can't hear it, but throw on some headphones and go back, listen to it. So let's go back to this. So, especially after such a climax as what you have with that, the end of that bridge, it can be really effective to then break it down to the smallest the song has ever been, partially to make sure that that final chorus part isn't disappointing, because honestly, that bridge is so huge and momentous and sort of epic within the context of this song, that if you just went right back into belting the chorus might feel almost disappointing. But you set it up by sort of having the most intimate chorus yet, because it literally has just an acoustic guitar being strummed in his voice. I'm not quite, normally in this section, this is where you would also take it down an octave singing wise. Not quite sure why they didn't do that. I feel like it would make it even better. This is a common trick to do after a bridge to sort of maintain interest. Because again, epicness, how big something feels, how interesting something is often, it's just by contrast, right? So we just had this huge bridge. The best way to make the next part interesting is not to maintain that hugeness for the chorus, but it's actually to break it down and have like the smallest part of the song yet, right? If that bridge is an 8 out of 10 epic wise, bring it down all the way down to a 2 to 10, gets your attention again, right? Because you almost got used to how big the bridge sounded, and now it's this really intimate one person with their guitar singing. Which draws attention to it. And then when the second half of the chorus explodes back into that full chorus with both of the main guitar parts and all the other instruments, it really helps so that it is emotionally sold. So just breaks down just before that you go. Said to make your heart beat better. If only I'd have known you were the most intimate chorus yet, and then so biggest chorus yet. Tied for the second verse, I think it's the same. Was there something I could have said to make it all stop hurting? It kills me how your mind can make you feel so worthless. So before. Also notice there's this little like, hey, shout when he sings go, which I honestly hadn't noticed until I was listening to this song today. It just helps to give that little accentuation to the end. So I think let's talk some big picture takeaways before we call it a day. So one is, I think chord progression is something that people often obsess over. But in the scheme of listening to that song, how much did chord progression really matter? I would say the most it really mattered. And again, it's not like you can make any chords you want, right? It has to match with the melody. But chords often are sort of like a good sound guy, right? Good sound person, somebody running the sound. You know they're doing a good job when you don't notice them, right? Because if you're thinking about the sound person, it's probably because something sounds wrong, so now you're thinking of them. But otherwise, you're just engaged in the concert, right? It's something taking you out of that engagement that makes you notice it. I feel fairly similarly with a chord progression. Generally, a chord progression should be a solid complement to the melody so that you're not pulled out of the song like, oh, that's awkward. So chord progression is important, just like a sound person is very important. But it's not the highlight. It's not the main thing you notice, which is how so many really solid songs can get away with sometimes very lackluster chord progressions, right? The chord progression doesn't necessarily have to be interesting. I personally like to make slightly more interesting chord progressions, right? A part of what helps this be a little more interesting is the use of the sus4 down into the regular 5 chord. Little things like that can make a really, really big difference. He never fully commits to a full 1-5-6-4. It always has like at least a little adjustment, right? The verses aren't 1-5-6-4, it's the 1-6-4-5. And then even the 5 goes sus4 to B flat. But notice for the most part, right? This is still built around 4 chords. Sure, you have the sus4. But besides that, it really is just the 1-4-5-6 chord. The only different chord thrown in here is a sus4 version of the 5 chord. So, me being a person who honestly, like I make a lot of use of the 3 chord. The 3 chord is one of my favorites. I just love that sound of 3 chord into a 4 chord. It just sounds, I love it. And I use 2 chords quite a bit as well. 7 chords are generally borderline unusable. At least in their diminished state. If you'd use a borrowed chord, that's a different thing, but that's getting the weeds. We don't want to go there. So takeaway is, hey, look, worry maybe about those chords less. This is why I often encourage people don't start with a chord progression, because chord progression is the most insignificant part of your song as far as like making like, the things you notice in this song, I would think, are hopefully lyrics, if you're a lyricist. If you're not a lyricist, maybe not. But if you're a lyricist, I really hope you notice lyrics. And then the melody, right? The melody is what carries songs. That's the main body of, like, work that gives you feelings and emotions. The chord progression is very much a secondary player. Not that it's less important, per se. It's just a complementary piece. Chord progression is meant to be complementary, right? It's because chord progression really is just harmony, right? Really what you have is melody, harmony, and lyrics. Because harmony is just anything that's sort of complementing the melody. So whether that's another vocal or a guitar or a piano or a bass, it doesn't really matter. It all adds up to harmony, unless it's a lead guitar and it's doing the melody for a little bit. Sure, yes. But generally speaking, melody is your vocal, and then most of the other instrumentation is differing forms of harmony. And the purpose of harmony is to supplement melody. Melody is overridingly the most important part of any song, even a classical piece, right? There's still a clear melody in almost all of those, right? If you think a Hans Zimmer piece, Hans Zimmer is one of the few that is a little less melodic. Better example, maybe John Williams, right? Yeah, they're great compositions. They're awesome. But you know the melody. Right? When you sing, you know, whether it's the melody of Duel of the Fates from Star Wars or Imperial March, Vader's theme, right? Like it's the melody you sing, right? Like the harmony doesn't even really occur to you. So write the more important stuff first. Get that melody out. Get that, you know, maybe make an interesting guitar riff or a piano part, which has chords underneath it, right? Like any piano part you have implies chords at least. But don't just come up with like, well, I'm going to use a 1-5-6-4 or I'm going to use a 1-6-5 chord progression. Like don't do that. Don't do that. It needs to complement the other parts of the song. Allow it to come out naturally. So that's one takeaway, at least I have, / some preaching that I wanted to do. And then just think a little bit about word painting. Something that he does really well that I think is subtle in the song is what we talked about with that. I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, but I was just kidding myself. And then went little by little by little until there's nothing at all. Because it does something special lyrically in that both of those things are more impactful by being repeated. And it really conveys more of an image, right? Little by little by little. That's the compromise that's dangerous, right? If little by little is just kind of like, yep, okay, little by little, but little by little by little, that really starts to accentuate it. And often, you know, to make a point, you do thing and repeat repetitions in threes, which that's by threes. And then I hate you, I hate you, I hate you, sort of trying to convince yourself. That's just really well done to sort of accentuate the point of that while also doubling as it changes up the rhythm to really capture your attention. Also, solid first line. I've talked before about the importance of a first line to catch you, right? I fell by the wayside like everyone else. Right away, you're like, oh man, where's this going, right? Like, I fell by the wayside like everyone else. It's already this depressing opening that has you wondering, wanting to know more. So, great song, Mr. Louis Capaldi, who also, by the way, little shout out to him. I will say I looked at his YouTube channel a bit and he is hilarious. He has these other random videos. Hilarious. If music didn't work out for him, he probably could have done well as a stand-up comedian if he wanted. So I hope this was helpful to you. I hope you found this interesting and helpful. That's the goal. I hope that you are entertained by it, but that you are also learning things by it and that you can then take these things that you learn and ideas that you get from things I point out. And hopefully you just sort of learn to listen to music more analytically so that you can then use things you learn from music. Cause you can't learn too much from music if you're not listening analytically, right? You're just listening for enjoyment, right? That's why you might have a friend who listens to twice as much music as you do, but they still wouldn't know a thing about writing a song and don't even notice half the things in their songs, right? Cause they're not listening analytically. They're just listening for enjoyment. So hopefully this also gets you a little practice into like maybe how to listen a little more analytically. If it was helpful to you and you haven't already, be sure to drop a like. It helps with the YouTube algorithm. And hey, this stuff is helpful to you. Subscribe, click that little notification bell. And again, if you were confused by any of the music theory I said, or if you just want to learn the just four pillars of music theory that I promise you will make songwriting, I can't even imagine songwriting without these four pillars of music theory. I had to for a little while when I was in like ninth and 10th grade. And now I can't imagine going back. It just makes it so much easier, so much faster. Free guide below. I 100% promise it will be helpful to you. So be sure to pick that up. And I will talk to you next week.